In the last two examples, we focused on non-electrolytic solutes, meaning molecular or covalent compounds, so something like sugar, for example. When sugar dissolves in water, it just breaks apart into individual sugar molecules. It doesn't break apart into smaller bits. When an ionic compound like salt dissolves in water, however, it actually breaks apart into its individual ions. So you actually get more particles from an ionic compound than you do from a molecular or covalent compound. One molecule of sugar will dissolve to form one molecule of sugar. One formula unit of table salt, however, will form one cation of sodium and one anion of chloride. This is accounted for in something called the Van't Hoff factor. The Van't Hoff factor tells you how many particles you get when one unit of solute dissolves. So for a molecular or covalent compound like sugar, the Van't Hoff factor is 1. For every one molecule, you get one molecule. But for an ionic compound like NaCl, the Van't Hoff factor is 2, because when NaCl dissolves, you get an Na plus and a Cl minus. For something like calcium chloride, CaCl2, the Van't Hoff factor is actually 3. You get one calcium ion and then 2 individual chloride ions. So in our previous examples, when we said non-electrolytic, we could ignore the Van't Hoff factor, because the Van't Hoff factor was 1 in all of our mathematical equations. In this next example, we have to pay attention to the Van't Hoff factor. I have 52.9 grams of copper 2 chloride, and I add it to 800 milliliters of water at 52 degrees Celsius. I know the vapor pressure of pure water at this temperature is 102.1 torr. I also know the density of water at 52 degrees Celsius is 0.987 grams per milliliter. So let's figure out what the change in the vapor pressure will be, or what will the new vapor pressure be for the copper 2 chloride solution. So let's begin with the copper 2 chloride. When CuCl2 dissolves, it breaks up into the copper 2 ion and 2 individual chloride ions. So one formula unit of copper 2 chloride produces 3 particles. We could say the Van't Hoff factor, and Van't Hoff factor is often used with a lowercase I. We could say the Van't Hoff factor for copper 2 chloride equals 3. We want to find the final vapor pressure of the solution. I know the initial vapor pressure of the solvent, water, so we need to find the mole fraction of the water. So I have 800 milliliters of water, and now the water is not at room temperature. It doesn't have a density of 1. It has a density of 0.987, so close, but not exactly 1. So 800 milliliters of water times 0.987 grams per milliliter means that my 800 milliliters of water translates to 789.6 grams of water. So the moles of water would be 43.82 moles. For the copper 2 chloride, I have 52.9 grams of CuCl2. So that comes out to 0.393 moles of CuCl2. So if we're to find the mole fraction of the solvent, so I could say the mole fraction of the water is going to equal my moles of water, which is 43.82 moles, divided by my total number of moles, which is 43.82 moles of water, plus copper 2 chloride breaks apart into the Cu and the 2 chlorides. So to find my total moles of solute, I have to find the number of moles of particles. So I'm going to take my moles of the copper 2 chloride and multiply it by the Van't Hoff factor. I'm going to take 0.393 and multiply it by 3. And that will tell me the true mole fraction of the water. That's a step we hadn't had to do in the previous problems because we were dealing with non-electrolytic solutes. So to find my mole fraction of the water, I take my 43.82 divided by 43.82 plus 3 times 0.393. And I get a mole fraction of my water of 0.9738. Now we can finish it up. I know that the vapor pressure is 102.1 for pure water, so my pressure for the solution is going to be my mole fraction of the solvent, 0.9738, times the vapor pressure of the pure solvent, 102.1 torr. And I get 99.4. for TOR for my new vapor pressure.